My name is Bobby Casturi. I'm an assistant professor at the University of Chicago and a neuroscientist at Argonne National Labs. What the connectome is it's a kind of a newly made up term for describing a kind of neuroscience research where we try to map the brain at a scale that's never been mapped before. Every person here can leave with understanding it at some level.
Do you know why we're here today?
Because we're talking about science.
Yes, we're going to talk about science, and we're going to talk about a very specific kind of science about people who study brains. Do you know what a brain is? What is it?
Something that helps you remember things.
Definitely. So what we're going to talk about is something that people study in a brain called the connectome. Do you know that your body is made up of really tiny things called cells?
Yes, I know.
Okay, well, there's more cells in your brain, like way more cells than all the stars we can see. And so what the connectome is we'd like to know where every cell in your brain is and how it talks to every other cell in your brain.
That was awesome, Daniel. Thank you.
Connectome. To be honest, I have no idea.
That's good. That's a great place to start. There are cells in your brain. Those brain cells are connected by wires to each other. Electricity travels down those wires and communicates from one part of the brain to the other part of the brain. And each of those brain cells makes, you know, 1,000 connections, something like 100 trillion connections.
Wow.
In one brain, in your brain. Could I take all of that information and put it inside a computer, would that computer then be you?
Computers, they don't have feelings. They won't have feelings. And I think that's one thing that makes the human race wrong.
I would say that that map also has your feelings in it. Because here's why. Your feelings, most neuroscientists think, come from your brain anyway. And amazingly, when you feel happy or sad or angry or scared, that's just brain cells communicating with each other. So I think today we're going to talk about a connectome. Have you ever heard of that?
A connectome?
Yeah.
No,
awesome.
I don't
Good.
Think so.
It's a map of all the connections between every neuron in your brain. Literally, in a human brain, something like the map of the 1 quadrillion connections that 100 billion neurons make with each other.
Is this like a map where that's like an actual visual representation, like using microscopy, or
yes.
just data? Wow.
Yeah.
I'm understanding more so that it's a mapping of the circuitry, the pathways between neurons that can lead to evidence of patterns in your brain that are common between different people.
We have to use electron microscopes.
Mm-hmm.
And then what we've been developing are ways to slice the brain into really thin slices, use an electron microscope to take a picture of each slice, and then use computers to put it all back. Imagine that we could get the map of every mm-hmm. connection, right? And we knew how neurons fired. Do you think we could put that in a computer, that map, and then therefore that computer should be able to think just like the brain that we extracted it from?
Well, the computer only communicates with itself in binary, so it only has two options. It can only ask itself yes or no questions, but a human brain has an infinity of directions that it can go.
Neurons are also digital, meaning a neuron either fires or it doesn't mm-hmm. fire. So that's either one or a zero. And it's the combination of those ones or zeros that actually produce the 10,000 different answers that you say.
It's a large-scale attempt to understand the wiring map of the brain, essentially.
Yeah, great. Mm-hmm.
I think that it's definitely needed.
Huh.
Understanding the anatomy of the brain is definitely important, but it doesn't necessarily tell us everything about the function. So there's some sort of temporal order from neuron to neuron and region to region that we may not be able to pick up.
this is where it gets really crazy. Mm-hmm. Could we simulate that map inside a computer? And would that computer then be thinking like that original brain for which we made the map?
I mean, that's not the person. I mean, having a representation of someone's neural network is just that. It's just a representation of their neural network.
Huh. I mean, because there's more to you in here than just information passing between neurons.
I'd like to think so.
Huh. It would be like if you simulated a hurricane. Imagine we could keep track of every variable of a hurricane. Wind speed, every water molecule, et cetera, temperature. And we put that inside a super fast computer, mm-hmm. and we simulated it, right? I don't think anyone would think that the inside of the computer would get wet, even though we had simulated the hurricane mm-hmm. perfectly. That wetness is consciousness, is what we are. Is it ethical to imagine mapping a male brain versus a female brain to look for differences between those, to explain alleged behavioral differences between them?
Every single person is different, and so it should be okay to map every single person's brain. I mean, I understand that it's very sensitive, you know.
Wait, what do you think is sensitive?
Mapping an Indian brain versus a Caucasian brain, or politically, I think that people may have some issue with mapping out what causes or what makes a difference between different types of people.
Maybe a wiring diagram is not sufficient to understand a brain. And it would be crazy to think that that would be sufficient, actually.
If you limit the connectome to be just the wiring diagram without, you know, more information about myelination or glial cells or
Correct.
All types of environmental features that surround, you know, the neurons and axons, then you have an incomplete picture.
Right.
No doubt.
Sometimes when people get, they worry about connectomics, I think what they're actually worrying about is that it's the end of the way that we used to do neuroscience.
What do you think about memory? Do you think that there's ways of resolving what the substrate of human memory is? You know, is it just LTP and LTD?
I'm not sure if you had a connectome of a human brain, of an adult human, I would be able to read out memories from that.
You don't think it's just the synaptic weights, like an artificial neural network gets trained to do particular
things? It could absolutely be, but without knowing what the weights were before the memory was made.
What if you had a violinist learn a piece of Bach music, and you
yes.
know, could you find those notes somewhere in their brain that
yes.
they didn't know before?
Yes.
You know, I'm a musician, and I don't think it's possible. I think that there are too many, you know, so much of it is associative to what you already know.
And as a musician, how much of it do you think is in your hands versus in your brains? Meaning, like, you do have connections in your muscles from the nerves that are from your spinal cord. What if some of the learning is there?
Are you still doing EM or?
Yeah, I mean, we do a lot of X-ray in addition to EM. And this is actually, I'm not saying it's the only problem, but it's the only problem that needs to be solved right away, is that the data analysis, right? In fact, I think we calculated that there aren't enough humans ever to map a mouse brain, where you collect every connection and et cetera. So the problem is to get algorithms to trace, to recognize things in brains the way humans recognize things in brains, or map things, trace things in brains. It's gonna cost a lot of money to imagine setting the gold standard for the wiring diagram, even once, and that's what those are the kinds of ethical concerns that I'm worried about. One of the things that we're not doing well as a field is sort of educating and telling people beyond our field the benefits of what we could achieve. And I'm impressed that when you talk to people about something that seems kind of crazy and outlandish and perhaps they hadn't been talking about before, it doesn't take them long to come to a kind of considered opinion, especially children. I think it's kind of amazing. I mean, I do hope that more people talk about brains and what we use brains for and the ways that we shouldn't use our brains. So I think this field has the opportunity to make that more real.